Alice's Wild West Show, a silent short from 1924. This was one, or even the first, ever portrayals of Native Americans in animation. This one quick scene began decades-long stereotyping of Native Americans in animation. From how they were drawn to the background music that follows them everywhere, this was the very beginning. The animation was created by Disney, an animation studio that would soon dominate the cultural arena in the United States, and eventually, the entire globe. This was not the end of Disney's portrayal of Native Americans in their films, but the beginning of a history of poor representation of Native Americans to come.
Come on, everybody. Here we go! Up to Neverland!
In the late 1940s and early 50s, the development of an animated adaptation of Peter Pan began production at Disney. The plot of the film is very similar to the stage play, including the characters of the so-called Piccaninny tribe. The inclusion of Native Americans in Neverland is already a destructive idea. Everything in Neverland is magical or make-believe, like the mermaids or the outlandish swashbuckling pirates. Including Native Americans only adds to the idea that they are not real or furthers the theory of the vanishing Indian, which in a post-World War II America was prominent because of the conformity and anti-communist ideals at the time. The Native Americans depicted in the film are also not of any one tribe and continue the long-standing media trope of lumping every tribe into one Native culture. Not only did Disney continue to include the Native American characters when there was no true need to, but they also replaced the original stage play song of Ooga Wooga with something much more problematic, the song, What Makes the Red Man Red?
Why does he ask you how?
The song makes up short stories that describe multiple stereotypes of Native Americans and their language in favor of childish jokes. Along with that, they are colored literally red, enforcing even more harmful stereotypes. The Natives and the Lost Boys also use terms for Native Americans originally used to mock their accents back in the colonial era. Here, you can see that Tiger Lily has been completely whitewashed, having much lighter skin as well as more European features compared to the other Native Americans who have extremely exaggerated features that make them look drastically different than the white Lost Boys. The other Native Americans are also colored a deep red compared to Tiger Lily. Because the song also tells a story about an Indian prince who kissed a maid and began to blush, and that's why their skin is red, implies that at one point Native Americans were white and had some sort of event to make them the way that they are. Obviously, this song in particular was not very well received in the years following since the movie was released in 1953, even to the point where if you go and watch the movie today on Disney Plus, there is a 10-second disclaimer that will appear before you even start the movie. In an attempt to reconcile with the criticisms Disney was receiving for this song, Disney historian Jim Corcus said, "It is important to remember that Peter Pan was supposed to represent a young boy's impression of pirates, mermaids, and Indians, and, as a result, these fanciful creations bore more of a relation to popular culture storybooks than reality." Now let's fast forward to the 90s. The 90s began a new type of Native American representation in films and media. The film started to have the Native Americans as the good guys, while the white men were not necessarily the bad guys, but were portrayed usually as misguided, but led astray by a villain or arch nemesis. The Native Americans were also led by a white savior, usually a friend of the Native Americans, or someone who was adopted by them. This was in an attempt to portray a sense of we are the same between the whites and the Native Americans, something that would be only furthered by Disney's Pocahontas. The 90s also saw a new era for Disney. After the death of Walt Disney, the company went into shambles and slowly was underperforming in their animated films. It wasn't until 1989's The Little Mermaid that Disney once again became the powerhouse of animation in Hollywood. Throughout the 90s, Disney saw what is now known as the Disney Renaissance era. After the success of Beauty and the Beast and its unprecedented Oscar nomination, Disney was looking to gain more success through award nominations like Beauty and the Beast. Aladdin and The Lion King were too far along in production, so then Disney studio chairman Jeffrey Katzenberg chose Pocahontas as the next candidate. Because of this, the story was quickly changed to become more mature. The story was to be more focused on the serious romance between John Smith and Pocahontas. Many animators jumped ship on The Lion King because, within the studio, Pocahontas was rumored to be a much bigger success and a more artistic film. This was the first time a Disney movie was going to be based in reality. Here lies the primary issue. The historical narrative of Pocahontas does not fit the Disney storytelling style. Because of this, the Disney Pocahontas was imagined as an older character, and John Smith was reimagined from a harsh and unlikable man to a dashing young adventurer, and both were in a Romeo and Juliet type romance. The film faced much criticism for aging up Pocahontas.
The story is really Pocahontas' story, although we have taken some liberties with it. We knew that she was a bit younger when she met John Smith than we show her in the film.
Supervising animator Glenn Keane claimed, "We had the choice of being historically accurate or socially responsible, so we chose the socially responsible side by increasing Pocahontas' age from a girl into a young woman." Pocahontas also became very hypersexualized in the film. Keane, in a 1995 interview, also claimed, "We're doing a mature love story here, and we've got to draw her as such. She has to be sexy," says Keane, who likens her to a tribal Eve. "This is a Disney version. This is not a documentary." After the overt racism in Peter Pan, Disney attempted to reconcile this by only including Native American voices for the Native characters. The production team even made a trip to Jamestown. While there, they met Shirley Little Dove Costello McGowan, a descendant of the Powhatan tribe. McGowan eventually served as a consultant for the film, but after learning the major creative liberties that were taken in favor of historical accuracy, wished her name was not credited on the film. Once the film was released, the Disney executives were surprised at the mixed reviews. This was not the overwhelming praise they had expected.
You don't have a really great, fun villain, and so the movie, as a result, is kind of serious and a little bit of a downer at times.
What's wrong with that?
Nothing is wrong with it.
Roger,
but what I'm talking about is the entertainment value of the film.
You're forcing this to be like the other pictures, and this film wants to be a little bit. It is a more serious subject matter.
Well, if you were going to rank the five, where would you place it?
I wouldn't put it at the bottom. I'd probably put it in the middle. My favorite is Beauty and the Beast, and I have a real affection for Little Mermaid. But this is this is serious themes. This isn't about the underwater fantasy characters. This is real stuff. It should be more serious. And I really think that the film communicates at a whole other level.
I'm not criticizing. I'm making an observation about the entertainment value of the movie, and I think it's valid.
The entertainment value is in the drawing and in the great themes. I think it's a real special piece of work.
The film still currently holds a 55% on the movie critic site Rotten Tomatoes. The critic consensus states, "Pocahontas means well and has moments of startling beauty, but it's largely a bland, uninspired effort, with uneven plotting and an unfortunate lack of fun." The film also receives mixed reviews from Native Americans. Russell Means, who provides the voice of Chief Powhatan in the film, said, "The single finest work ever done on American Indians by Hollywood, because it was willing to tell the truth." And, "Anyone who tries to find the negatives in Pocahontas, at best, have suffered a loss of innocence," Means said. "At worst, they don't like children. And my perspective is, what's good for the children?" However, others like Fern Mathias, director of the Southern California chapter of the American Indian Movement and a member of the Sisseton Wahpeton Dakota Nation, claimed, "We are not beat on the tom-tom people. This movie reinforces that image. It reinforces genocide, imperialism, and racism."
What can you expect from filthy little heathens? Here's what you get when races are diverse. Their skin's a hellish red. They're only good when dead. They're vermin, as I said, and worse.
They're savages, savages.
Barely even human.
Savages, savages.
Drive them from our shore. They're not like you and me, which means they must be evil. We must stop the problems of war.
They're savages, savages.
Dirty, freaking devils. Now we sound the drums of war.
This is what we feared. The pale face is a demon. The only thing they feel at all is greed. Beneath that milky hide, there's emptiness inside.
I wonder if they even bleed.
They're savages, savages.
Barely even human.
Savages, savages.
Killers at the core. They're different from us, which means they can't be trusted. We must sound the drums of war.
They're savages, savages.
First we deal with this one.
Then we sound the drums of war.
Let's go get a few men.
Savages, savages.
Now it's up to you, men.
Savages, savages. They're even human. Now we sound the drums of war.
Savages attempts to be a song that presents the Native Americans and the white settlers as similar, both sharing the view that the other group are warmongering savages. To quote Dustin DeVore, author of One Little, Two Little, Three Little Stereotypes, A History of Native Culture and Imagery in American Cinematic Cartoons, when viewed in the full context of the movie, coupled with a basic understanding of European settlement in the New World, the song Savages is not particularly offensive. It uses the derogatory term savages, but it is meant to juxtapose the innocence of Native Americans against the savagery of Europeans. The dangerous assumption is that the audience understands how the animators intended the song to be interpreted. The reason Pocahontas did not work was because the historical narrative just did not fit into the Disney narrative. Despite Disney attempting to be culturally sensitive by hiring Native voice actors and seeking out Native Americans consultants, this movie was not going to work, especially in the stereotypical Disney film. The romance came before the culture. Native American portrayals virtually disappeared after Pocahontas in the late 90s. However, in the early 2000s, Disney attempted a new approach. In response to their past films, Disney began to create films that took place in the pre-colonial era. They took the white people out of the equation. Modern Disney films with Native American representation started on a trend of the main protagonist turning into some sort of animal or creature to learn a lesson, like in both The Emperor's New Groove, released in 2000, and Brother Bear, released in 2003. The Emperor's New Groove takes place in the Incan Empire and has virtually no essence of the culture, in favor of making a buddy comedy where Emperor Cusco turns into a llama in order to learn how to be less selfish.
Where? You kidnapped me!
Why would I kidnap a llama?
You're the criminal mastermind, not me.
Brother Bear sees the protagonist Kanai turn into a brown bear in order to learn a lesson about respecting nature. Disney has since released a few new titles with indigenous people as the main characters in their movies. They still use an approach of having them set in pre-colonial times so there are no white people. Despite having more representation visually, as well as behind the scenes with cast and crew, their movies still have characters fall into stereotypes that are called out for being offensive. Disney has definitely come a long way since 1924's Alice's Wild West. However, they still have a lot of improving to do in order to be culturally respectful and responsible.